My name is Chris Martin. I'm on the faculty at Georgia Tech, and I'm going to talk to you about why your classes involve group work and why you have listening exercises. The traditional classroom is a lecture hall where a professor talks about a sequence of topics. A good lecture can be very insightful, but it has some drawbacks having to do with memory. Ideally, we would like to remember everything we hear in a lecture and recall it whenever we need to. However, memory isn't that simple. Psychologists typically divide memory into three components. First, there's sensory memory. If you're awake and paying attention to something, anything really, it's in your sensory memory where it stays for a very short period of time. Sometimes when you're looking at a bright light source and you look away for a moment, you still see the light. That's because it's in your sensory memory. Many things pass through your sensory memory and then disappear. But some things go into short-term memory. Short-term memory allows you to hold a few pieces of information at the same time for a few seconds. For example, try to memorize this 4-digit number. Can you still remember it? That's your short-term memory in action. That number isn't very important, though, and it's unlikely you'll remember it next week or even later today because it's not in your long-term memory. Some of what goes into your short-term memory does get encoded into long-term memory, which is why you can remember some things for years. For instance, when you were a child, you probably heard a story about two siblings lost in a forest who met a witch who wanted to turn children into gingerbread. If you remember the name of the boy and girl in the story, it's because of two things. First, those names are stored in your long-term memory, and second, you're able to retrieve them. In case you don't remember their names are Luke and Leia, or perhaps Hansel and Gretel. You probably retrieve their names easily, but there are times when you can't retrieve memories that you know you had. Everyone has had the experience of forgetting an important bit of information during an exam and then remembering it after the exam has ended. Now, if you're at a very effective lecture, some of what you hear gets encoded into long-term memory and is easy to retrieve. More likely, however, a lot of it just gets stored in short-term memory and then gets forgotten. You hear the professor go through a sequence of topics and you take notes because you know you're not going to remember what you just listened to. To a small extent, long-term memory is like a bank. You can keep depositing memories into it and withdrawing memories from it. But this analogy isn't very useful because it fails to capture that retrieval from long-term memory is also like a muscular process. Exercise in retrieval makes you stronger. A lack of exercise makes you weaker. And when you're exercising, just as you have to drop the barbell before you pick it up again, you have to forget things and then practice retrieving them again, none of which happens in the typical lecture. If you work in pairs or groups, what you learn is more likely to be stored in long-term memory and be easily retrieved for several reasons. First, you're more likely to be re-exposed to older class material when you're conversing with someone. So if you didn't store it the first time around, you have another chance to encode it. This doesn't happen in most lectures. Second, you're also likely to be exposed to a new technique or a new piece of information that's not in a lecture, something that your teammates know from their previous experience. Third, you have occasions when your partner gives you a fragment of information that prompts you to retrieve something from your long-term memory. They give you a cue, but not a complete idea, and you have to retrieve the full idea. That makes you practice retrieval, which is like doing a bicep curl. Again, this doesn't usually happen in a lecture. And you have complementary memory when you work together, which means your teammate might recall something you've forgotten, and you might recall something they've forgotten. Putting those two things together might help you solve a complex problem. As a result, you learn to solve problems that are too complex for individual homework. You're exposed to the strategy for solving these difficult problems, which you can then try to remember and retrieve in the future. There are also some benefits that are related to learning, but not memory per se. For example, when you have a group of three people or more, you have to negotiate the perspectives of other people in the team. This requires more effort than listening to a lecture. You have to figure out why two people have different ideas about solving the same problem. Figuring out why they have different ideas helps you understand a subject at a deeper level. Finally, you're more alert when you're doing group work. You can get drowsy or start daydreaming in lectures. You can even fall asleep in a boring lecture. All of us have done that at some point in our lives. But having a conversation keeps you alert and awake. However, there are a couple of drawbacks to learning in teams. First, there's social loafing. Social loafing is a term coined by psychologists to describe our tendency to slack off or put less effort into team tasks than individual tasks. This can happen in classwork, and when you have a distraction like a cell phone nearby, it's especially likely. Second, we're afraid of making a bad impression, so we often avoid risks. You can often think of a creative solution that is so unconventional, you assume that you're going to look stupid for bringing it up. It's one that you might use when doing individual homework, but one that you don't bring up when doing group work. But that idea could be the key to solving the problem in front of you. This is what psychologists call a lack of psychological safety. The reason that we ask you to do listing exercises is that when you have team cohesion, that is, you trust each other and care about each other's growth as a student, you're less likely to engage in social loafing because you care about your teammates, and you're more likely to have psychological safety and take risks because you've built trust. This doesn't just make your work go smoothly, it also helps you maximize the benefits and minimize the drawbacks of learning together.